provided by the Annenberg CPB Project and the Ford Foundation. Additional funding by the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations.
4-6, get that motor set up on the hill. I won't fire in 1 minute.
Okay.
58,000 Americans died in the Vietnam War. Even today, few Americans understand why. Officially, it was a war against international communism. In fact, Americans collided with a much older force, the force of nationalism. To understand the power of nationalism is to know the story of two men who led the fight for independence in Asia. The Vietnamese revolutionary Ho Chi Minh and Indonesia's founding father, Sukarno. They destroyed forever the myth of Western supremacy. And from ancient cultures and traditions, they forged new nations.
Alhamdulillah, sekarang di halaman ini telah berkibar sang dwi warna.
By the end of the 19th century, much of Asia was ruled by European powers. Indochina was a French colony. And the Dutch ruled Indonesia, known then as the East Indies. For the people of the East Indies, freedom from the Dutch began with an ancient myth. For over 2,000 years in the shadow puppet play called Wayang Kulit, they have relived the ancient combats of the Mahabharata, an epic tale of a virtuous family's struggle to cast out evil invaders from their land. But by the early 20th century, the shadow battles of the Wayang Kulit had become symbolic wars of liberation against the hated Dutch. It was in 1596 that Dutch warships first appeared among the 14,000 islands known today as Indonesia, a vast archipelago stretching 3,000 miles from the Indian Ocean to Australia's Great Barrier Reef. In these East Indies, as they called them, the Dutch discovered the treasure they had sailed so far to find. Four hundred years ago, before refrigeration, nutmeg's power to preserve meat and improve its flavor made it as important to the European economy as oil is today. Dutch businessmen made huge fortunes meeting the demand for nutmeg in the West. By the early 20th century, the Dutch discovered much more than nutmeg. There was rich volcanic soil to grow coffee, sugar, and tea. There was oil, minerals, and lumber. And to harvest these riches, there was Indonesian labor.
May not a man in Europe do what he likes with his cattle? Even so does a master here do with his men. For these and all that belong to them are as much the property of the master as our brute beasts.
So boasted one of the first governors of the Dutch East Indies in 1600. By the 20th century, little had changed. But Indonesians could not band together to resist the colonizers. The East Indies were a wild array of some 300 different cultures. From Melanesian cannibals to the elegant courtiers of the Sultan of Yogyakarta. The outnumbered Dutch controlled the Indies by shifting alliances with local potentates and pitting different regions against each other. Those who resisted were killed. Indonesia's islands are still littered with Dutch cannon. The Dutch were devout Protestants who saw conquest as proof of divine favor. Their God was a mighty fortress, and the rich land of Indonesia was their earthly paradise. Indonesians prayed for a paradise to come. Most were Muslims, converted over centuries by Islamic traders and teachers who sailed here from India and the Middle East. In the early 20th century, rumors spread that a child of Muhammad would fall from heaven and deliver them from the Dutch. It was a time of signs and wonders, and of yearning for a Messiah whose advent seemed long overdue.
We were very poor, the Indonesian people, most of them. And there was this resentment, this hatred, this anger hidden inside all of us, you know, on the island of Java. There rose a myth of the coming of a just king. So people deep within them hope for a change, a big change. To freedom from this misery, this oppression, this poverty, and this, this not being able to express yourself as a free man or a free people.
For many Indonesians, there was a divine path to freedom. In the villages, Islam mingled freely with Hindu and Buddhist traditions, and mysticism was a part of daily life. But in the cities, a handful of Indonesians learned Western ideas of freedom in Dutch colonial schools.
The Dutch, they taught us Dutch history, and we know their fighting against the Spanish, their 80 years war in 1568 till 1648. We have to learn it by heart. And we know that they were fighting for their independence. And why should we not be allowed to get our independence?
At the turn of the century, one young student combined a hatred of the Dutch and a fondness for Western democracy with the oldest myths and deepest yearnings of his people. His name was Sukarno. He would become the fulfiller of prophecies, the longed-for Messiah, the leader of a revolution. In Vietnam, another young patriot was searching for an answer to the challenge of the West.
Thank you.
Vietnam's lush fertility once made it the crown jewel of France's colonial empire. The French first came to Vietnam as missionaries, then as traders, and finally as conquerors. By 1900, Vietnamese labor was providing the French with enormous profits from rubber, from tea, and from rice. Their control of the country was ruthless and absolute. They assumed Vietnam would be theirs forever. But the Vietnamese had a long tradition of overcoming foreign oppression. In Hanoi, Buddhist nuns still chant daily in praise of a humble peasant who liberated Vietnam from China 200 years ago, the Emperor Quan Chu. Today, the Quan Chu nuns also keep the cult of Vietnam's 20th century liberator, Ho Chi Minh. Ho Chi Minh is a Chinese name, meaning bringer of enlightenment. Ho's real name was Win Tat Tan. As a young man, he saw his countrymen brutally defeated in feudal uprisings against the French. He realized that beating the French required an entirely different strategy.
Ho Chi Minh decided that he would go to Europe and see what people do in Europe. The Vietnamese have a saying, if you want to catch a tiger, you must go to the gate of its lair. So Ho Chi Minh decided to go to the gate of the tiger.
In 1911, Ho Chi Minh left his village in northern Vietnam and came to Saigon, Vietnam's commercial opening on the world. At Saigon Harbor, Ho signed on as a cabin boy of a French freighter bound for the West. He visited New York and worked as a dishwasher in London. In 1917, he arrived in Paris and quietly settled at the Tiger's Gate. He would watch with horror and amazement as Western civilization devoured itself. World War I was a European war, but it had a powerful effect on Asia. In 1917, China and Japan joined the Allied side. Both wanted the German territories in China. China sent 200,000 men in work battalions to France. The French sent 100,000 Indo-Chinese troops and laborers to the Western Front. These Asians had little impact on the outcome of the war, but witnessing the war shattered their illusions about Western supremacy. They had seen nations which claimed to be morally superior use the power of their technology and science to destroy each other. Eight million men died. 22 million were seriously wounded. One Chinese intellectual wrote a letter home from France.
Europeans are like travelers in a desert and have lost the direction. They once had a great dream about the omnipotence of science. Now, their talk is filled with its bankruptcy.
But from the collapse of one old European regime came a new social vision. It was the Russian Revolution of 1917, and it gave Asian intellectuals hope. Lenin claimed that the capitalist economies of the West were tottering and saving themselves only by exploiting the labor and resources of their overseas colonies. For proud patriots like Ho Chi Minh, it was the first explanation of the plight of Asians which did not humiliate them. By the World War's end, Ho Chi Minh had become a well-known figure among the Parisian left. He called himself Win Ai Kwok, Win who loves his country. To his astonishment, in the tiger's lair, he had found sympathy for his cause.
It was quite a shock to him, because in Vietnam, the Vietnamese are nothing. Under the French rule, they were kicked, they were ill-treated. But once he came to France, people called him Mr. Sir. And then when he visited the French socialist newspaper, Le Populaire, then the editor told him, my comrade, my friend, we shall help you. Now, there is something very new.
Lenin was not Ho Chi Minh's only hero. When the war ended in 1919, the Allied powers met at Versailles to design the post-war world. Ho and many other Asians pinned their hopes on the American president, Woodrow Wilson. In his famous 14 points, Wilson had called for self-determination for all the world's peoples. Ho took his own plan for Vietnamese independence to the Versailles Conference, but he was barred from entering. From that day on, the mysterious Win Ai Kwok was a hero to his countrymen.
He became the symbol of the dreams of our youth of these days. Somewhere in Paris, at the center of France, a Vietnamese stood up and said, we want independence for Vietnam. That is very great for most Vietnamese.
At Versailles, Ho Chi Minh learned that American democratic ideals did not extend to the colonies of America's ally, France. As he watched the surging crowds cheering the agreement signed by the great powers, Ho understood, once and for all, who his real friends would be. 6 months after the Versailles Treaty, Ho Chi Minh helped found the French Communist Party. In 1923, he left Paris for Moscow. For the next 20 years, he would devote himself to the world communist movement, determined that someday Vietnam would have the freedom denied her at Versailles. In 1920, Indonesians organized the first communist party in Asia. In 1927, Indonesia's communists rose in revolt. The Dutch crushed the rebellion and executed its leaders. With the communists finished, the Dutch relaxed. They thought they had destroyed all opposition to their rule. They were wrong.
We came to the realization that we really belong to one nation only very late. I think in 1920s, you know, 1927, 28, when the younger generation of Indonesians came to realize that we could never win back our independence without becoming united as one nation. And I and my friends became very attracted to the red and white flag of Indonesia. We joined up with the nationalist scout movement. There we were told by our older brothers and by the older leaders, you must not forget, not ever forget, they told us that in this fight, our main enemies are two, the capitalists and the imperialists, and both are Dutchmen.
But most of the nationalist leaders were intellectuals educated in Holland, more at home in the West than in their native land. What the movement needed was a charismatic leader, someone who could persuade millions of ordinary Indonesians to forget their tribal loyalties and unite as one people against the Dutch. In the late 1920s, that leader appeared. The schoolboy Sukarno had come of age.
Anybody who listened to his speech would be moved. He was able to empathize with the desires of the common people.
Pengisi spirit, pengisi semangat daripada rakyat itu sendiri.
He gave the people a sense of self-confidence. Kepada setiap yang mendengarnya.
Sukarno's own self-confidence was limitless, especially with women. He once said, "The smile of a beautiful girl is God's reflection. Why is it a sin to take her?" To his countrymen, he was an irresistible mix of playboy, patriot, and matinee idol.
Sukarno is like in America, a combination of George Washington and Clark Gable. The first time I met him as a younger man, he's already asking what movement, youth movement you are joining. And then he's explaining, I have to join one of the movements. And I follow him.
Sukarno preached the need for national unity and the dignity of the common man. He was fiercely anti-capitalist, but he was not a communist. He simply believed the Indonesian masses should be free to labor for themselves, not for the Dutch.
I was consumed by a burning desire to set my people free. It was more than a duty. For me, it was a religion.
As a boy, Sukarno was spellbound by the heroic warriors of the Wayang Kulit, and by the Dalang, the master puppeteer who enthralls his audience with epic battles he conjures from lamplight and shadows. As a man, Sukarno became the great Dalang of Indonesia's nationalist struggle. Over his people, he cast his own hypnotic spell of modern revolutionary thought and ancient Indonesian myth.
The Dalang manipulates the puppets, so Sukarno also manipulates our own people and all the mystical forces in our culture for his own political ends. He can quote you Marx, he can quote you Jefferson and the other Western philosophers, you know, very easily. I have got them all in his mind. But at the same time, he also used these old mythical symbols of Indonesia, especially of Java and Bali. He used to tell people in Bali that he is a descendant from Vishnu, the Hindu god. So when he arrived in Bali and it was done raining, he told the people, look, I bring rain for your rice fields, you know, things like that. And he could do it very well indeed, that maybe he's one, you know.
The Dutch were also impressed. In 1929, they arrested Sukarno and other nationalist leaders. In 1933, they exiled them to remote outer islands. Indonesia's deliverance from the Dutch would have to wait, until events outside the country recalled an ancient prophecy of yellow-skinned liberators from the north. On December 7th, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. On December 8th, the Japanese attacked the British colony of Malaya. On December 10th, they landed on the Philippines. On Christmas Day, they captured Hong Kong. The The Japanese armies continued driving south, crushing Western colonial forces in their path. They occupied French Indochina and took the British bastion of Singapore. At the end of February 1942, their invasion fleet appeared off the coast of Java. As the Japanese grew near, Indonesians quietly hoped. In 90 days, they had seen an Asian country humble the power of England, America, and France. Perhaps the ancient prophecies of deliverance were about to be fulfilled.
You might have heard that there was a Joyoboyo king in the 13th century who predicted that once Indonesia will lose its freedom, and then later on, after so many years of white supremacy, will come a yellow ox coming here in Indonesia only for the duration of the maize plant, you know, of the corn plant. And after that, then we will be free. Well, that is the Japanese. So when the Japanese arrived, my mother, you know, is planting a corn plant to see whether it comes true.
Eight days later, the Dutch surrendered all of Indonesia. Seeing their masters humiliated, Indonesians rejoiced. After 300 years of Dutch invincibility, it truly seemed that a miracle had happened. The Japanese armies continued driving south, crushing Western colonial forces in their path. They occupied French Indochina and took the British bastion of Singapore. At the end of February 1942, their invasion fleet appeared off the coast of Java. Eight days later, the Dutch surrendered all of Indonesia. Seeing their masters humiliated, Indonesians rejoiced. After 300 years of Dutch invincibility, it truly seemed that a miracle had happened.
The Indonesians lined up the streets and cheered the Japanese troops who came marching into Jakarta after the defeat of the Dutch army. I was there waving to them, you know, shouting them, banzai, you know, very happy, you know, that now the Dutch were gone from Indonesia.
The Japanese proclaimed Indonesia free from colonialism, and they promised a glorious future in what Japan called the Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere.
They said it is Asia for the Asians. It's part of the nationalism, yeah? And so Sukarno and other leaders believed at the beginning they come to help us. But you have the same problem after that. After they have been here 1 year maybe or more, then they are colonizers.
Indonesians soon found themselves laboring for Japan as they had formerly labored for the Dutch. A member of the Japanese Occupation Command remembers.
Materials.
Raw materials. Japan was only interested in the raw materials. Foremost was oil, then there was tin, bauxite, rubber. All those things that we did not have but needed. Japanese policy was to take advantage of people like Sukarno and to give them some form of leadership. Sukarno was grateful to the Japanese for having gotten rid of the Dutch. But he also doubted if Japan would ever deliver on its promises of independence. Even with these doubts, he felt he had to get as much as he could from the Japanese.
Sukarno took a dangerous course. He became a propagandist for the Japanese and tried to use the pulpit Japan gave him to carry on his campaign for Indonesian unity and independence.
Kita mendirikan negara Indonesia yang merdeka, bersatu, berdaulat, adil, dan makmur, yang tetap menghargai budi jasa dai Nippon, dan hidup sebagai anggota yang sejati dalam lingkungan keluarga Asia Timur Raya.
But Sukarno's pact with the Japanese proved to be a devil's bargain, as the Japanese began to demand more than rhetoric. The Japanese needed more manpower. They ordered Sukarno to lure Indonesian men into work battalions. The Japanese called them Romusha. Sukarno told them they were heroes of labor.
Menjadi peluru bagi musuh yang akan menghancur leburkan musuh itu. Maka saudara-saudara akan bekerja dengan giat. Marilah saudara-saudara kita mulai bekerja. Sekarang tebalkan saudara punya tangan semuanya. Mari kita dengungkan bersama-sama semboyan kita. Tirukan perkataan saya. Hancurkanlah.
Hancurkanlah.
Musuh kita.
Musuh kita.
Ya itu. Inggris.
Inggris.
Amerika.
Amerika.
The Romusha were shipped off to forced labor throughout the Japanese Empire, where they died by the thousands.
After the war, I met two young Indonesians who were formerly belonged to this contract coolies, or Romusha, of the Japanese army. And they look like some guys who came out from Belsen camp, you know, the Nazi camp in Germany. Because they told us, we were like this, we were sick. If everybody who was sick will not be given food by the Japanese, no medicines. Only if you continue to work, then they will give you some medicine and some food. Otherwise, they did not give you anything at all.
The suffering of the Romusha still haunts the memory of Sukarno's role in Indonesian history. By the end of 1944, American forces had shattered Japan's defenses in the Pacific, and American bombers were pounding Japanese cities. The Japanese needed Indonesians' resources and cooperation more than ever. The Japanese reconsidered Sukarno's pleas. Facing defeat, a desperate Japan promised Indonesia its independence in return for Indonesia's continued support of the Japanese war effort. An elated Sukarno swore that Indonesia and Japan would fight together to the end. And he won a crucial concession from the Japanese. Japanese agreed to give Indonesians arms and training to help them repel an Allied invasion. But Sukarno had a hidden agenda. He wanted an army to fight the Dutch if Japan lost the war.
We know that the Japanese will lose. Why not to take that opportunity to get the military training? So there's not a question of collaboration. The Dutch has left us, you know, unarmed and uneducated into the hands of the Japanese. So what is wrong to have our own tactics?
But the war would end sooner than anyone imagined. On August 6, 1945, an American atomic bomb killed 100,000 people in the Japanese city of Hiroshima. On August 9th at Nagasaki, a second atomic bomb killed 35,000 people. On August 15th, Japan surrendered. At first, Sukarno could not believe that two bombs had destroyed the mighty Japanese empire. Now there was very little time to negotiate independence from the Japanese.
They all knew that if the Dutch came back, independence was dead. A few days after the war ended, Sukarno went up to many Japanese and honestly felt sorry for their loss. And I don't believe his tears were an act.
On August 17th, at the home of a sympathetic Japanese admiral, Sukarno and fellow nationalist Mohammed Hatta declared Indonesia an independent nation. They raised a homemade red and white flag on a bamboo pole. The little group gathered around the flagpole and sang the new country's national anthem. For the time being, Indonesia was free. Ho Chi Minh was hiding in the tiny village of Tan Trao in the mountains northwest of Hanoi when he heard that the Second World War was over. He knew the moment he had worked for all his life had come. In 1941, after 30 years in exile, Ho had sneaked back into Vietnam to lead his revolution. In Russia, the communists had taught him the importance of the revolutionary vanguard, a small group of dedicated revolutionaries who could seize power and mobilize a nation. Ho's revolutionary vanguard was called the League for Vietnamese Independence, or Viet Minh. Its commander was a young history teacher named Vo Nguyen Giap, whose wife and sister-in-law had been guillotined by the French.
We met on the hill close to the banyan tree. Under the leadership of President Ho Chi Minh, the Central Committee decided that the time for the general uprising had come. In the evening of the 16th, I gathered the liberation forces under the tree in Tan Trao, and I read the first military orders. At that time, the uprising took place in many parts of Vietnam.
Meeting little opposition, Ho's ragtag army raced from its mountain strongholds toward Hanoi. Ho knew the French would not wait long to reclaim their richest colony. He wanted to seize control of the country before the French returned. On August 19th, the Viet Minh entered Hanoi and seized control of the country from the puppet regime installed by the Japanese.
We had three battalions. Each one had three companies, so they sort of made up battalions. And one thing I would like to mention is that among our troops at that time, there were three Americans.
To fight the Japanese, American OSS commandos had parachuted into Vietnam at the end of the war to give weapons and training to the Viet Minh. Ho had provided the American forces in China with intelligence during the war.
When I was with Ho and Giap in the field, I got the impression that they would fight no matter how long it would take to achieve their independence. He told one French person that we may lose 10 men to every one that we may kill of you, but in the end, we will prevail. There was this fierce rage. The Vietnamese people, they had been humiliated by having France occupy their country for 80 years.
But Ho felt differently about the United States, owing to the foreign policy of President Franklin Roosevelt.
It was quite well known that Franklin Roosevelt was against the French colonization of Indochina. And consequently, Ho felt very kindly disposed towards the Americans because he felt we were against colonialism. He told me privately that he would welcome 1 million American soldiers, but not one French soldier.
26 years after Versailles, Ho Chi Minh again pinned his hopes on the United States.
Cho nên ông Hồ mà đi theo cái đi đi
Ho Chi Minh's belief in the help of America had its logic.
Là có lý, chứ không phải là không có lý.
The issue was not that Ho Chi Minh wanted to establish a communist country. The main issues were independence, freedom, and democracy, not a communist Vietnam.
Ông Hồ muốn nước Việt Nam độc lập, cộng hòa, dân chủ. Rồi sao sai?
Later, we'd see about communism.
Là dân chủ, là tự do, không phải là nước Việt Nam cộng sản.
On September 2nd, 1945, Ho Chi Minh read Vietnam's Declaration of Independence to a huge crowd in Hanoi. Its opening words came from Thomas Jefferson.
Không ai có thể xâm phạm được. Trong những quyền ấy có quyền được sống, quyền tự do và quyền mưu cầu hạnh phúc.
When Ho Chi Minh declared his country free and independent, here he was in Ba Dinh Square at a big platform. And standing there, reading a Declaration of Independence, and here was this tremendous crowd below, thousands of people in front of him. He says, "Do you hear me, countrymen? Do you hear me?" And they shouted back, "Yes," that they heard him.
The crowd celebrating independence waved American flags and carried a homemade portrait of the new American president, Harry Truman. Ho wrote to Truman asking his help in protecting Vietnam's independence from France. Truman never replied.
When Truman took over, our whole foreign policy changed. Our sympathies became aligned with the French. My own view is that the people in Washington just did not understand this fierce desire on the part of the Vietnamese people to be independent.
In October 1945, the State Department announced that the United States would respect French sovereignty in Indochina. By the end of 1945, the French had returned. Late in 1946, uneasy negotiations between France and Ho's government broke down. Fighting erupted between French forces and the Viet Minh. After 16 months as president of a free Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh fled again into the mountains. His dreams of independence shattered. He would ready the Viet Minh for a guerrilla war that would last 30 years. In 1945, Ho Chi Minh also wrote to Sukarno, suggesting that Vietnam and Indonesia help each other in the post-war struggle against their former colonial masters. Like Truman, Sukarno did not reply. He was sympathetic to Ho, but afraid of contact with a communist leader as the Cold War became more apparent. Indonesia had its own problems. During the war, the Dutch had fled into exile or had been brutally interned by the Japanese. Now they vowed to punish Sukarno for collaborating with the Japanese and to take back the Dutch East Indies. In In September 1945, British troops landed on Java to take the Japanese surrender. The British brought Dutch exiles with them. The Dutch freed their imprisoned countrymen and gave them arms. The Allies ordered Indonesians to surrender the weapons given them by the Japanese. The Indonesians refused. Within weeks, fighting began. In October at Surabaya, Indonesians battled the British and their Indian troops called Gurkhas.
Every day you had fighting. The British occupying half of the city, and we are in the southern parts. At some morning, I was still working at my headquarters, and then a girl came in better dress, came there and put the head of a Gurkha officer in front of me on my table. With his ribbons completely. He has fought already in the Second World War.
The Indonesians fought fiercely for 3 weeks. Though the outcome was inconclusive, the Battle of Surabaya inspired many more Indonesians to fight. Militant youth groups became the core of a new revolutionary army. Youth leaders, barely out of their teens, quickly became senior officers in the struggle against the British and the Dutch. One of these was Abdul Haris Nasution, who would become chief of staff of the Indonesian army.
I can hide me among the paddy fields, but the Dutch soldiers are not going through the paddy fields, they are going through the dikes. We are in our own country. The people is our, the terrain is our. We can be everywhere. If the people is loyal to the Republic, then the army can move everywhere and have its own security, logistics with the people.
United by their hatred of the Dutch, Indonesians in the countryside banded together to form a guerrilla army. At the same time, a new government proclaimed by Sukarno attempted to negotiate with the Dutch. The Dutch insisted that Sukarno was both a Japanese collaborator and a communist. In 1947, the talks broke down and the war began in earnest. The Dutch attacked with armored divisions and air support. Within 2 weeks, they controlled all the major cities on Java and Sumatra. Indonesians still ruled the countryside. In the midst of the fighting, some Dutch were also troubled by conscience. One Dutch soldier, H.C. Prinsen, actually switched sides.
We had lived through the German occupation. I had been in German prison myself in concentration camps. So this, I felt very upset that we are going to do the same thing in Indonesia that the Germans had done against us. Once I came to Indonesia, it appeared to be true that we were fighting for the return of our profits. So in 1948, I decided that the moment had come, and I went to the other side.
In the midst of the struggle against the Dutch, Indonesian communists tried to take control of the country. They were crushed not by the Dutch, but by General Nasution's Indonesian army. In December, the Dutch used the confusion to launch an offensive. They captured Sukarno and the Dutch capital of Yogyakarta. Sukarno's supporters appealed to the United States. The United States had refused to intervene in the struggle because the Dutch had assured them that Sukarno was a communist. Now convinced that Sukarno was not a communist, the U.S. threatened to cut off Marshall Plan aid to Holland unless the Dutch left Indonesia. The Dutch agreed to a ceasefire. There was bitter fighting until the very end.
I had married a woman from here, and then the last day before the ceasefire, they killed my wife and 20 of my soldiers. So they were still able to hit me at the last moment.
On December 27th, 1949, the Dutch finally relinquished their control over their old East Indies Empire. The Dutch agreed to Indonesia's sovereignty. The next day, mobbed by cheering crowds, Sukarno drove to the Governor General's palace.
Raised both hands high. A stillness swept over the millions. There wasn't a sound, except for the silent tears. Nothing moved.
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Thank God we are free.
Vietnam would travel a more difficult road to freedom.
Okay, look out to the right now. Okay, right down there. Okay, nip up now. There it goes. Ah, look at it burn. Look at it burn.
In 1954, Ho Chi Minh won his war against the French, only to see the superpowers divide his country in two. During the Cold War, Ho's political philosophy would make him powerful enemies. Ho Chi Minh died in 1969 while his country was being pounded by America's enormous might. Before the war ended, 58,000 Americans and hundreds of thousands of Vietnamese would die. But in 1975, Vietnam would have the independence Ho had sought for so long. While the Cold War devastated Vietnam, Sukarno tried to play the superpowers against each other. He became a flamboyant spokesman for the newly independent, non-aligned countries who refused to ally themselves with the West or the Soviet bloc. Like the puppet master in Java's shadow plays, Sukarno tried to captivate Indonesians by the sheer force of his personality. But the mythic fire that had led a revolution could not run a nation day by day. By the 1960s, the economy was a shambles. People were starving. Sukarno flirted with communism as Indonesia began slipping from Sukarno's grasp.
In the end, our big darling Sukarno lost his control on his shadow puppets. And the shadow puppets become their own masters and play their own game.
In the fall of 1965, conspirators in Jakarta, most likely communists, murdered six of Indonesia's top military leaders. In the chaos that followed the attempted coup, the Indonesian army seized control of the country. In the name of order, the army pushed Sukarno aside and gave power to a pragmatic young general named Suharto. Today, Indonesia is still ruled by Suharto and the military. Its economy is booming, though the country is plagued by corruption and authoritarian rule. Sukarno died in 1970. In the villages, some say that on the night he died, they saw his face in the moon, and there was thunder and lightning for 3 days. Today, long lines of Vietnamese wait patiently to view the body of Ho Chi Minh. But others question whether Ho would have approved of the state cult Vietnam's communist government has created around him. After decades of war, Vietnam has a powerful army and one of the poorest economies in Asia. Its Soviet ally is gone. America is ending its economic embargo, and reformers are calling for change. Today, the legacy of Ho Chi Minh is a powerful riddle. Will the nationalism he inspired lead the nation forward to economic progress, or backward to a vision of the world that has since disappeared?
Major funding for this program was provided by the Annenberg CPB Project and the Ford Foundation. Additional funding by the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations.